Leonardo da Vinci, Richard Feynman, and you. What do you have in common? An enormous corpus callosum, the connections between your left and right brain, the basis for creativity. It's time for Science Without Walls. Let's go back, way back, to program number one, the science of art, the art of science. We said that scientists and artists are both creative, as are many other members of our society. Creativity, what does the word mean? What is your definition? Is it looking at things in a new way? Do the words new, novel, original, inventive, genius all come to mind? Albert Einstein was certainly creative. So were Leonardo da Vinci and Richard Feynman. All the great scientists and artists are said to have been creative, to have been geniuses. Many inventors fall into that category, and many engineers. Creative people see things in a new light, in a new way. Albert Sangiorgi, who won a Nobel Prize in chemistry for discovering vitamin C, said, it is, quote, to see what others have seen, but to think what no one has thought, unquote. Children tend to be very creative. They don't know what is correct, what is accepted, what is right, so they combine things, put things together in novel and unusual ways. This is how they do their scientific exploration, their scientific questioning, trying to make sense of their natural world. This is their scientific method. It's also their artistic method, splashing paint, mixing, drawing squiggles. It's okay, we're learning, we're being creative. By the time we get to your age, and certainly my age, we've tried to learn so much, to memorize, to regurgitate. It's difficult to put down our defenses, to really look at a situation, a phenomenon, an experiment in a childlike manner. We've learned too many rights and wrongs, too many expected answers, too many points taken off on exams for not having the right answer. Most of us have inhibited our intrinsic creativity. I've spent most of my professional life working with graduate students and research staff. In graduate school and in research labs, you're not supposed to believe what you read. You're expected to question, to be critical, skeptical. You're supposed to do experiments and write dissertations that are new and novel. You are supposed to take old data and look at it in new ways, or generate new data and somehow relate it, explain it, in light of what's gone before, or come up with even totally new models and explanations. Most students have the creativity beaten out of them in our highly structured, exam-based, right-answer-based educational and social system. To be truly creative, you have to let go of some of those academic and social defenses. Let loose, so to speak. You cannot only look at things from the point of view of the textbook, or the teacher, or your boss. Look at things differently, creatively, part of the time. Yes, I know it's hard to do. It takes a certain degree of naivete and a bit of a devil-may-care attitude with respect to how your teachers or peers think of you. The title of this book, by your now good friend Richard Feynman, says it all. What do you care what other people think? Now, you know, I don't want you to go off the deep end with this, but do try to look at things differently, from a fresh perspective. And do push and extend yourself. Strive for personal excellence in everything you do. This wonderful but largely forgotten book says it very well. It's John Gardner's Excellence. He says, being excellent is not being the very best. It is being performing far better than you, or perhaps the others around you, ever thought you could. He says there is an excellence within the reach of every individual. An excellent plumber is infinitely more admirable than an incompetent philosopher. We appreciate excellence in athletics, in physical performance. We appreciate excellence in music, and we need to appreciate it as well in other forms of creativity, and indeed in all endeavors. And for all of us, excellence should not just be a spectator sport. We should not just appreciate excellence. We should practice it in everything we do. Again, in the words of John Gardner, we need excellent physicists and excellent construction workers, excellent legislators and excellent first grade teachers. We need an approach to excellence and a conception of excellence that will bring the whole society to the peak of performance. A good and entertaining and related motivator is the film The Right Stuff and General Chuck Yeager's attitude and accomplishments. His own autobiography, Yeager, is very good reading. We are all unique. We each have a different set of experiences, genes, background, interests, skills, and neural wiring. The transient epicenters assembling in your brain right now are different than in mine. That epicenter, that transient thought, may be totally new and unique. The trick is to connect a thought, which may not itself be at all unique, to a very different thought, which also by itself may not be unique. But by putting those two different thoughts together, you may indeed make a special combination, one that hasn't been made before. Remember, there are thousands of epicenters firing, more or less randomly and simultaneously, in your brain. You are choosing, perhaps consciously, perhaps subconsciously, which ones to grow, to focus on. Let them grow. Let them connect. Fantasize a bit. Enjoy some internal, mental, creative hallucinations. A friend of mine at the University of Utah, an individual known internationally for his creativity, for his accomplishments and inventions, now has Alzheimer's disease. He is a scientist and engineer who has had a very successful, productive, and rewarding career. He is not depressed or negative about being a victim of medical statistics. He tries to look at the situation objectively and creatively, tries to understand what's going on and what is not going on in his own brain. He had Alzheimer's for several years before it really became a problem and was diagnosed. I asked him to look back and, from the perspective of hindsight, how he might have realized earlier that Alzheimer's was developing within him. He said the first thing to go, the first indication that he had a neural or mental problem, was that he wasn't getting new ideas as often as he used to. His creative skills were diminished. He couldn't make those connections that he used to make so effortlessly. Alzheimer's disease causes damage to some of the neural tissues, interfering with neural processing across those damaged areas. So it's perhaps not surprising that one of the first things to go and one of the first things to be recognized in some Alzheimer's cases is diminished creativity. We've used Leonardo as one of our heroes, one of our icons. But Leonardo did not have a particularly good reputation in his own time as a finisher of projects. Very creative people are sometimes blessed with so many creative ideas that they indeed have trouble focusing. Leonardo had a lot of unfinished projects in his career. Sometimes very creative people, like Leonardo, can be too creative in the sense that they are always getting new thoughts and ideas and want to deal with them. These ultra-creative folks like to start things, like to address the problem, lay out a solution, and then they prefer to move on to other ideas. They often leave the finishing to other folks. That may be okay, as long as somebody else finishes those projects. But if not, those creative folks are often labeled flaky or scatterbrained or some other less positive descriptor. The trick is to balance creativity and commitment, to have ideas, to carefully sieve and select your new ideas, and to have the persistence and the dedication to see your selected ideas through to some level of completion. There are indeed many connections and similarities between science and art. Jacob Bronowski, who has written a great deal on this subject, has said, "We expect artists as well as scientists to be forward-looking, to fly in the face of what is established, and to create not what is acceptable, but what will become accepted. One result of this prizing of originality is that the artist shares the unpopularity of the scientist. The public often dislikes and fears the way that both of them look at the world." The connections between art and science don't just involve creativity. Great contributions are not solely in great art, which changes one's way of looking at things, or great science, which discovers new and novel principles or relationships. Creativity also involves unique communication and inspirational skills. Here's one of my heroines. Rachel Carson died in 1964 of cancer. Writing this book probably hastened her death. Her 1962 book, Silent Spring, is recognized as one of the most important books of the 20th century. Rachel Carson did not get a Nobel Prize in biology. She wasn't particularly recognized as an outstanding biologist or scientist, although she did have very impressive scientific skills. She was a writer and was already known as an outstanding science writer from her popular science books, The Edge of the Sea and The Sea Around Us. In the early years of this century, man really began to master chemistry. We learned how to make and characterize organic compounds of a wide variety of types and forms. We learned how to make synthetic polymers, which led to the plastics industry and all the plastic products around you today. We learned how to make drugs, which increased man's health and longevity, and pesticides and herbicides, which greatly increased agricultural production. All of this was so new, so novel, and so wonderful that we, society, accepted it all uncritically and naively, rarely if ever asking if there were side effects, disadvantages, or a downside to the production and use of these many new and novel chemicals. Rachel Carson was a shy, reserved, somewhat anonymous writer who was not interested in public exposure or the limelight. One reviewer of her book said, quote, "The author is not an alarmist, but a trained, meticulously scrupulous scientist who shuns publicity and controversy, but whose findings were too catastrophic to keep to herself," unquote. Rachel Carson was convinced by a friend to look into the problem of chemicals in the environment, particularly herbicides and pesticides, and most specifically DDT, an absolutely revolutionary and remarkable chemical which was being widely used in the late 1950s. I urge you to read Silent Spring. It is excellent science writing. Think of it as a historical book, a book that aroused the American people and their government to dramatically change their behavior in a very short period of time. Almost everyone now points to the publication of Silent Spring as the birth of America's environmental consciousness. It led to the establishment of the Environmental Protection Agency in 1970. It led to the major national initiatives dealing with air and water pollution control. Rachel Carson never dreamt that her book would generate the interest, the controversy, and the action which it did. Although she was terminally ill during part of the writing, she forced herself to do scrupulous, methodical research and evaluation, which provides the substance of the book. But that itself would not have been enough. It would have just been another well-intentioned book. What made it unique and so very special was her writing talent, the book's readability. You know the difference between a well-written book and other books. It was Rachel Carson's exquisite writing skill, coupled with her scientific skills and reputation, which made this book so powerful and so important. She wrote, rewrote, and rewrote again, and edited and re-edited, pruning, honing, tuning, like all really good writers. The point? If you have an interest in writing and have writing skills and talents, and if some of what we've talked about in the past 39 programs interests you, combine those interests. Consider science writing. I assure you that good writing talents and a strong interest in science is a unique combination. Science writing is a highly useful, productive, and rewarding career. If you can't write, but you can draw, even if you're no Rembrandt or Leonardo, who is? Draw science stuff, perhaps like the work of Paul Klee, or Gary Larson of the Far Side fame, or Bill Watterson, the father of Calvin and Hobbes. They and other outstanding cartoonists are incredibly creative artists. They have a way of taking a concept, a situation, an issue of some importance and significance, and like many so-called modern artists, presenting it in a very easy, understandable, sometimes provocative way to a wide audience. Picasso could be a great cartoonist when he wanted to. Political cartoonists are probably the most influential people in our society today. Many great scientists sketch their ideas and concepts in simple form with cartoon or icon-like drawings. What helped give Richard Feynman his insight to quantum electrodynamics was the Feynman diagrams, which he devised and enjoyed, even using them to decorate his Volkswagen minivan. Utah's Willem Kolff, one of two Utahns in the National Inventors Hall of Fame, and internationally recognized for his development and invention of the artificial kidney and the artificial heart, is also an artist who loves to draw and sketch his inventions. He even makes whimsical modern sculptures. Samuel Morse of the Morse code and Robert Fulton of steamboat fame were artists before they were inventors, and so was Leonardo. In the days before photography, many scientists had to be artists to be able to draw their observations. Many artists, scientists, have made very important contributions to both art and science. John James Audubon in the worlds of ornithology and zoology. Frank Netter, who presented so clearly and accurately the details of human anatomy in the decades before computer graphics. In the area of photography, great artists like Ansel Adams brought the beauty and frailty of the natural world to our scientific and artistic attention. And of course, the other wildlife photographers and filmmakers who showed us the living natural world and taught us to appreciate and protect it.
Approximately 200 grizzly bears live in Yellowstone National Park. An interagency team closely monitors the great bear's fragile existence.
Artists and scientists in the very best senses of both of those words. Folks with interests and skills in the humanities and the arts bring totally new perspectives to the sciences and to engineering. A good example is the birth of the University of Utah's Department of Computer Science, which pioneered the development of computer graphics over 30 years ago. Computer graphics was transformed from basically simply putting points and lines on a computer screen to what you saw in the films Jurassic Park and Toy Story. The development of modern computer graphics required unique partnerships and collaborations among people with computer, mathematics, electronics, and artistic talents. David Evans, the founding chairman of the Department of Computer Science, accepted into his graduate program in the College of Engineering artists and musicians with little or no formal technical or scientific training. He justified such actions to his skeptical and critical faculty colleagues by saying that he needed an environment in which artists, musicians, engineers, and mathematicians could work together, interacting, creating, stimulating each other. It worked. The University of Utah, Salt Lake City, and the Evans and Sutherland Computer Corporation are internationally recognized in computer graphics, including applications to scientific visualization and to the fine arts. But it's not only the visual arts. Music and sound were also connected to and through computers, including the development of digital audio by Tom Stockham and his colleagues in electrical engineering, initiating a revolution in sound production and reproduction. Collaboration between engineers, physiologists, dancers, and sports people, together with designers, simulators, and builders, is critical to the unique accomplishments of Dr. Stephen Jacobson's Center for Engineering Design and its internationally recognized robotics capabilities.
Hey, this is great. I've got power again. Boy, you know, every time I power up, my head starts spinning with all the things I could do, things I could be.
There's a very transient, unpredictable, uncertain nature to thoughts, to ideas, to inspiration and creativity. There is so little we really know about how the brain works, about how you and your Homo sapiens cousins utilize your right and left brain and the connections between them to create. There are those who argue that the brain operates on quantum principles and Heisenberg uncertainties. There are others who argue that there are unique forces at work in the brain, possibly a fifth fundamental force, which has not yet been discovered. There are people who are reported to be able to transmit energies and forces to inanimate objects and even to other people. There is growing interest in the Western world today in Chinese and Oriental medicine. Qi, or its counterparts in other Eastern cultures, refers to an energy balance and energy focus in certain individuals. There are those who have worked with Qi masters, including individuals who appear to be able to impart forces or energies onto others. Some observers suggest that these individuals are physically drained after this force transmission process, physically tired. You know that thinking, studying, intense, highly motivated mental activity can indeed make you physically tired. And that's certainly not due to doing macroscopic work in the sense of Newtonian physics. But information does require energy, and so does creativity. Mental work and inspiration do require ATP to power all that neural firing. Your new friend, Christian de Dove, says, quote, "The mind is a special manifestation of matter," unquote. He goes on to say, as you've already heard, that if this means invoking a property not yet included in the descriptions of physics, this would not be the first time. He quotes a neurophysiologist, George Edelman, another Nobel Prize winner, and author of the book Brilliant Air, Brilliant Fire, as saying, quote, "Why not propose that additional, as yet undiscovered, physical fields might reveal the true nature of consciousness," unquote. Edelman and de Dove, and of course Susan Greenfield, as well as the others who have written recently on this subject, may indeed be right. Maybe the brain has a lot to teach us, not only about thought, consciousness, and creativity, but even about the physical world. Maybe you'll be part of that grand adventure.